All right, you guys, thank you all for getting on this call. I am so excited to get on and just share some things that have been on my heart and on my mind lately, some things that are working for me, and just the mental shifts that I have had and all of that fun stuff. So my name is Brigitta Limford, and you may be sponsored by me, you may be sponsored by someone on our team. I love that we collaborate together and work together as a team for calls and things like that. So welcome. I'm glad that you are here. Now I'm going to share my screen with you guys because I am a very visual learner. And so I like having slides. It kind of helps me stay on track too as I'm going about this. So I think I'm kind of notorious for having some random titles for my webinars, and this is no exception. So I titled this My Turnaround Permission Slips, Band-Aids and Living an Extraordinary Life. Now, I will tell you that this kind of came to me as I have been talking with more coaches lately who are stepping back into the business, perhaps, that may have felt that, you know, they were stepping away, or they are jumping back into really building this in a big way after maybe taking a break. And I just wanted to share some things that I've kind of worked through the last couple years, because I jumped into this business and just...
Well, right.
Do you know where my tablet is?
It's up on top of the thing.
Okay. Got everyone muted. But I didn't really feel a lot of mental hangups as I got started in this business. And something kind of shifted for me the beginning of last year, kind of the end of 2016 and really all of 2017. And I had a lot of hangups on things and some experiences that happened that really affected me in a big way. And so I created some beliefs and some struggles in my business. And one of the beliefs that I created for some reason was that if I help people reach their goals, then I will lose them as a friend. And so I had this huge block on recruiting people and adding people into my challenge groups and adding people onto my team. And I share that because I have been surprised talking to coaches where they're like, I just kind of lost my mojo because I was so hurt to see one of my coaches cancel or one of my challengers drop out of this when I just really, really wanted them to have that transformation and I believed in them. And you just pour your heart and your soul into people. And, you know, I think it's easy in this business to like wear your heart on the sleeve, on your sleeve, and to kind of maybe feel trampled in a little way. And I definitely let that get the best of me. I also noticed when I joined the coach advisory board, for some reason, I felt like I needed to listen to everybody in the network to get a really good awareness of what was going on. The coach advisory board, there's 8 of us on there total. And I just thought for some reason, for me to do my job good in a good way, I needed to be super aware of what's going on. And the problem is that I spent too much time listening to negative people. And so I would hear people share their excuses of like, oh, this business is, you know, there's just always those people that have excuses. And I started letting that be such a loud voice in my head that I kind of started leaning towards these beliefs that I was hearing from other people. And, you know, some of the things that I was hearing is that this is going to be stressful. If you build this business, you have to like make all these sacrifices and everything will kind of fall apart in your life if you're working the business hard. And, you know, just these negative beliefs, maybe you're not hearing it from other people, but maybe you've had them in your own life of thinking, I'm not super bubbly and outgoing like Keisha, so I don't have the right personality, or I don't have the right background because I've never owned my own business. It's funny, I've heard the excuses of, I've had too many struggles in my life, there's all of these hard things that have happened in my life, and so I can't do this business because I've got to work through those things. And yet I've also heard the excuse of, well, I haven't had any struggles like you, so I can't build this business because I don't have a sob story. You know, again, I will get hurt. You know, I'm going to invest in people and then they will betray me or they will hurt me or they'll cancel, they'll quit, whatever. And it's just too much of an emotional roller coaster. I can't sign up for it. And I just want to say, like, is that really the truth? And I don't think that it is. Now, I feel that I've got a little mark on my screen and I don't know how to get rid of it. I don't know if you guys can see it too, but there's a blue line going through my slideshow and I don't know how to get rid of it. But I just want to point out, as I really dove into Brooke Castillo's podcast this last year, it was what I needed to shift things because I had gotten so used to those negative voices that I was hearing from others in the network that it just became my truth and I wasn't questioning it. And I was just like, yep, that's true. And I, like, you have to be willing to put your thoughts under a microscope and be like, is that the real reality here? Because whatever excuse you're giving yourself, sometimes you're being like, no, that's the truth though. And you don't want to have that maybe called out. And it's hard, literally, because our brains don't want to be wrong. And so we will filter and interpret all new information that come in so that our prior conclusions can stay intact. And contradicting information that will come in will be like, I'm going to turn that away as like not real truth. Because we want our brains to always be correct. And here's what I've realized is that we get to be compassionate with our brain. Because when we realize that something isn't true, I think there's even a grieving process that our brain goes through when it realizes it's wrong, which sounds kind of silly. But I do feel that we can be intentional about the thoughts that we have. And here are just a series of questions that will help assist you in that of, you know, what thoughts are fueling this emotion that I have. If you think about setting a goal for diamond and you have this fear because you're like, well, I've been a coach for 2 years and I haven't hit diamond yet, so that's not going to happen for me. Or you think about going elite and you're like, yeah, but I went for elite last year and I didn't hit that, and so that feels really scary for me. Identify what those thoughts are there and question it, you know? But one thing I just want to add to this is I do feel that there was kind of like this compensation plan change in the business when we shifted to Beachbody On Demand. And, you know, I've talked about this in other calls and we've talked about it, I think, on the team, but I just want to mention it because the only thing that I've been concerned about in this business are the coaches who have internalized everything. You know, like, I feel like we needed to work through things and get rid of the 10% discount and all of these things, because I really feel that coaches who were kind of getting started weren't maybe seeing a massive, like, growth that maybe they saw someone else have years prior. And I just want you to realize, like, there's no ceiling here. Like, there's nothing holding anybody back. And I feel that the coaches who will earn the most money are just getting started and are just joining our business or just like putting that pedal to the metal now. Like, the best coaches have not, like, you know, really had their time in the spotlight yet. And so I don't want anyone to internalize the past. Like, the past is in the past, and you'd be willing to, you know, have those thoughts of the future is the best to come. But I do want to share some of my turnaround in kind of getting over those fears and those hurts and everything for me. And I heard this quote today about, you know, this social media girl was talking about people who will unfollow you on your social media account. And I wrote it down because I was like, oh my gosh, just the way it was worded clicked for me. And she said, people will unfollow you not because of anything to do with you, but because it's just not their season to need your content at this time. And that hit me because I totally have had that happen. You know, I've had close friendships that maybe separated, or I've had coaches who have been like, oh my gosh, I'm so inspired by your Instagram account. And then I notice them unfollow my Instagram account. And I'm like, oh, like, you know, my natural instinct is be like, I'm so hurt. You know, like that hurts my feelings. But to realize that like everybody's on their own journey. And so as you're doing this business, you may have people who will cancel or who will drop out of a challenge group. But I just want you to realize it has nothing to do with you. And everybody's on a path that is for their best and highest good. And so like some people will come in and out of your life during the seasons where they're ready for what you have to offer, but you keep doing you. You know, you keep creating awesome content. You keep on posting. You keep on sharing. And you know that the friends, the family, the people who are uncomfortable with that, it's because you're moving forward. And if they're not, you physically cannot be coexisting moving forward. And that's okay. You will have the people who are moving forward as well that will do it with you. You're not going to be alone. You're not going to be lonely. But you got to keep moving forward. Like you owe it to yourself and be okay that there will be relationship seasons, you know, that some people will come in and out of your life, but they're still better for being a part of your journey. And I just want to mention that truly, even if a challenger comes into your group and they don't complete it, I so strongly feel that it was all meant to be the way that it happened and that their life is still touched for the better because they were in your group and because of the things that you did to invest in them and to share your heart with them. Like it was, you made that difference. For that coach who maybe canceled, like it's all okay because it's all, you know, the stepping stone that they needed in their life. And I mentioned this, like some people who maybe come into this who have a business background, like for Keisha with, you know, working in the corporate world, this is probably like so obvious. But for me and for many of the coaches that I have on our team, you've never had a career, like corporate career job before. And so you get into this and it's very blurred lines with like friendship, family, work relationships, and a team and all of that and all of these people that you invest in, and it feels all the same. You know, I have felt like my coaches are my family. My challenge groups are my family. Like to me, there was no separation. Like all of it I gave my whole heart to, all of it. And, you know, there's that hesitation of, well, I don't want to keep investing in people if I'm just going to get hurt. And I totally felt that last year, I will admit. Like I had a big fear of recruiting because I was like, I'm just going to be adding people who will hurt me. Like, I don't want to do that. And I heard this quote in a book and this person was talking to another corporate leader and saying, don't you ever worry about that? You know, making these big investments in the people who are working for your team and, you know, paying for them to go to these seminars and doing all of these things to make an investment in them. And what if they leave and go to another company? And he's like, no, I don't ever think about that because my greater fear is what if they stay and I don't make that investment? And I loved that. That really resonated for me because I'm like, I get to continue making an investment in people and stay open and know that it's always, always, always worth it. So all of that then kind of cleared that aspect of my fear of, you know, inviting essentially. The other, you know, fear that I heard from people were you can't build this business without being stressed. And if you really work really, really hard, then you're not going to have balance in your life. And I was hearing essentially that stress is required to achieve big things. And I just want to say, I don't think that's true. I don't believe that in any way. Because I loved what I heard in John Acuff's book, Finish. He talked about intentionally failing. And I love that because he's like, we have this lie in society where we feel like I can succeed in all things. I should be able to do it all. And the truth is, you don't just give time to something. You know, everyone comes into this, they're busy, you're like, have a career, you are working full time, you have kids, like you have so many things going on, and then you do Beachbody as well. And you add this in, and then you kind of have to realize, like, you come in thinking I should be able to do it all. But you do have to realize that you get to choose what you fail at, and so that you can thrive in the areas that matter the most to you. And I included this picture of The Bachelor because I have chosen to intentionally fail and really suck at all conversations about The Bachelor. Like, I don't even know their names. And it's fine, totally fine if you love The Bachelor, because again, you find the things like that you want to fail at, the things that matter to you. I go and get lash extensions and I sit there in a shower for an hour and a half every 3 weeks. So people could look at that and be like, that's such a waste of time. I'm choosing to do that. But it was funny to me, every time I go and get my lash extension, like it's on, it's silly, I know, lash extensions, but the lady doing it always wants to talk about The Bachelor. She like always is like, oh, did you watch The Bachelor? And I like have to remind her every time, like, oh no, I'm not watching it, but tell me about it. And I really suck at that conversation because I don't know what's going on. And today I heard about the whole 2-part, 3-hour finales that like I missed, that apparently was a grand total of 5-6 hours or something. But I'm failing in my knowledge of The Bachelor. And that's a choice that I made though. Like I intentionally chose that. And I don't watch TV because in the list of things, I was like, I'd rather spend the time on, for me, in doing lash extensions, maybe going to friends. And I'm not saying that you need to spend all your time doing Beachbody. My point is that you really only have so much time. So the time that you're not working, you still need to be intentional with that. Otherwise, it will eat into the time you want to give this, even, right? So I think it's smart to make a list of things that you will stop doing. That's your intentional failing list. I think so often we are like, here's my massive to-do list of all of the things I need to do for my power hour, for my business every day, and accomplish on a weekly basis. And I want you to make a list of things you're going to stop doing instead, you know, and realize that there are things that just don't matter right now. Because I don't want you to feel that you need to do more, but I want you to do the things that matter. Okay. Now, I'm going to shift and kind of share something that has made a big difference for me in this business, and it has to do with airplane mode. Now, when I think it was, last year, I set a New Year resolution that I wanted to learn how to fly. And so I kind of started in the November before. I tend to, my New Year's, and I feel the shifts typically in November of each year. But I signed up for flying lessons, and I was taking lessons to learn how to fly. And you know what was really unique for me is being up there in the air, and you have all of these controls in front of you, and so many things to pay attention to. Like, you have to be constantly looking around, and it amazes me how there could be a plane that 1 second was not there in my view, and then all of a sudden was like, whoa, like right there. So I mean, you just have to constantly be paying attention. You cannot tune out. You cannot zone out. Like, you have to be so in that moment. And it was so good for me because I tend to think about things constantly. And so I was in such a habit of always thinking about work, even if I wasn't working. And I would always be thinking about my family and like, I mean, what can I do for my kids? You know, what does Mac need? What is he dealing with right now? How can I help him? And what about Phoebe? Like, I kind of think she's been acting a certain way lately. Like, what do I need to do for them? And I'm just constantly thinking about my kids and constantly thinking about work of like, what can I do to make this better? And it's because I love both. You know, I love my kids. And so, of course, I want to think about them all the time. And I loved work, and I love work. Like, so, of course, I want to think about it all the time. And but the problem with that is that it ends up being that I felt I was failing in both. Because I could always think of something I should be doing for my kids and for my family, and something I should be doing for my business that I wasn't doing. And being forced to get up there in the plane and not think about my family and not think about work was so healthy for me, because I realized what it truly means to be in airplane mode. And that means my thoughts are in the moment in everything that I'm doing. And it forced me to learn how to do that, because my brain had never been forced to stay in the moment in all things. And I mean, that's what meditation is, right? You know, meditation is observing your thoughts, clearing your thoughts, and not thinking of anything, right? But what I realized in that is that I think anything is draining if you are doing one thing and thinking about something else. That's what's draining. And so I just think, guys, like as a society, we have not learned that skill of airplane mode. Like, how many of you are watching me and you're on Instagram right now, or you're checking your challenge group while you're listening? And I will tell you, you are not enjoying either one if you are trying to multitask right now. And it's just something that we do. Like, we're so squirrel brained that we're like, I should be doing this, but I'm like with my kids, but like liking images on Instagram, you know? And I just want to encourage you that if you want to love your life, be in the moment in everything that you do. Because that's why I think there's a lot of coaches who felt stressed out, because they loved this business so much, they couldn't stop thinking about it. But because they were still needed to do other things, like they were doing one thing and thinking about something else. And that is a recipe for misery. And so I want you to be present in the moment, in all of the things that you're doing, so that you can be a high achiever in all areas of your life. And I will tell you that I feel I have rocked this lately, and it has made such a huge difference in my life. Like, when I'm with my kids, I am like so with my kids, and I'm not thinking about work. I'm not like, oh, there's a message. Like, I totally just don't even think about it. And when I'm like working, I'm like not stressing out about my kids. And it's just been so invigorating, you know, and it's made it just fully energizing to experience it all. And I just feel that if you do that, like, you're not going to feel like you're failing in anything. Like, everything, you'll be like, I gave this moment my all. And you will lay down at night and be like, I rocked my day because I was in the moment during it all. Now, I made a Facebook post about this today, but I just wanted to add it on here because I really feel that this was the other shift that I made. Again, just being intentional in things. That's my word for the year, is intention, intentional. And I just realized that I don't need to work this business more. I just need to be really intentional about what's getting my time and my attention. And I realized, like, you know, I want to be done with work by the time the kids get home, and I have these like parameters, and yet I have big goals that I want to achieve. And I started thinking like, oh, maybe I just need to work more. And I was like, no, I just need to be intentional. Like, I am wasting so much time. And so I realized, like, I'm going to wake up and I'm going to get my day started and have that routine and be intentional about the bookends of my day. And the bookends of my day are the routines that I have in the morning to set myself up for success, and what I do at night to kind of wrap it all together and set myself up for success the next day. And, you know, I kind of went into this with a lot of little things. Like, you know, for me, one of the things was, I'm going to get up and get ready for my day. Like, I was, maybe sounds weird to some people, but working at home, like, I'm a mom, like, my kids don't care, my husband doesn't care if I like get ready for the day, but I'm like, it matters, you know? And at night I was being lazy and not washing my face at night. Probably grosses some of you out to even hear that, because you do that always. But I was going to bed with my makeup on and just not washing my face at night. And like little things, I'm like, how I start and how I end my day, it matters. And I'm going to be intentional about those things. And again, I really do feel that's made a difference. So I just wanted to throw that in there. All right, moving on. Let me get a drink real quick. Another thing that I want to talk to you guys about is writing yourself a permission slip. Now, I remember going on one particular trip back in 2016. And I remember at the time, a lot of my family members were really struggling with some heavy things. And I had a lot of friends who were struggling. And I remember I was going someplace fun. I can't remember exactly where. But I remember feeling so guilty, like leaving my kids at the time. And it just felt really stressful and chaotic as I was trying to get everything ready to leave. And I was on the airplane and listening to Brené Brown. And she talked about writing yourself a permission slip to be happy. And it stood out to me and it just hit me like a ton of bricks. And I remember thinking, this is exactly what I need to do because I have this relationship with myself. And many times I am holding myself hostage to what I think I need to feel or experience. And I just need to give myself permission to live a big life, to be happy, to enjoy things. And it is so funny, but I wrote myself a permission slip that day, and it seriously was like, everything just changed in that moment. I was like, I give myself permission to be goofy and happy and full of joy and enjoy this experience and not feel guilty for it. And it was such a big shift. And since then, I have written myself so many permission slips. And I don't know why, but it just seriously makes such a big difference for me. When I came into this year, I was like, I want to set these big goals and I want to do these things. And I kind of felt as I was sharing some of those with coaches that I could feel their resistance to my goals as if like, you know, I'm telling them I want to be elite, like I want to do this. I feel like our team can do this. And I felt like they had this belief that elite is hard and stressful and things like that. And they didn't want me to have that goal almost. And I noticed like that bothered me because it's almost like I wanted their permission. And so I caught myself being like, listen, I don't need anyone else's approval of my goals. And so I wrote down a bunch of things and bought myself this cute little holder. And I wrote down my goals and I didn't write it as like, I will do this. I wrote it as I give myself permission. You know, I give myself permission to lead an elite team. I give myself permission to be my best self in health and physical. I'm ready and giving myself permission to be my best self in the health and physical sense. Because I just feel like I've kind of struggled with my health lately. And I kind of put on there too, like I give myself permission to have a close friend and group of, you know, anyways, I just wrote out these things that were important to me. And I gave myself permission for them. And I have it on this, not even a pretty, I didn't even take the time to write it pretty, but this is on my desk. And I look at it every day and I'm like, I'm done holding myself back. Like I'm the only one holding myself back and I'm over it. Like I'm done. Because I've realized like, I don't know, like I have felt like I needed to be sad my whole life because I experienced abuse and I need to be this way. And because I was depressed, I still need to act like as a recovering depressed person to honor that. And all of these things, I'm just like, I'm so over it. And I don't know, like, I just feel we all kind of need to do that. You know, and I want you to think about, what do you need to give yourself permission for? Do you need to, even if it's just, I need to give myself permission to not think about work when I'm at work or when I'm with my family. Or I need to give myself permission to not think about my family when I'm at work. And that doesn't mean I'm a bad mom. Or I need to give myself permission to have fun with this. Like, I remember having this conversation with Keisha, and I'm kind of picking on her, I guess. But when she was like, I almost feel guilty that this is so fun because I don't feel like I'm working. And like, I feel guilty that like, this should be this. And I'm like, giving yourself that permission slip of like, dude, this is a legit job. Like, even though it doesn't feel like that serious corporate, you know, job that you had before. I also feel there is a permission to believe in yourself. And I, again, it's just been on my mind a lot about the relationship we have with ourselves and how that's so interesting. And I think that we are so aware of everything that we've done wrong and all of the times that we did something and now we don't deserve this or that. And I think it's really easy for us to be hard on ourselves. And I think you need to give yourself permission to believe in yourself. I heard this definition of believing in yourself, that it means that you know there's more to me than people see. And that's what it means to believe in yourself. I love that I don't watch The X Factor except for the YouTube specials, kind of, that they'll be like, oh, look at this person. But I love the episodes that I have seen where there's that moment of like a person standing up there on stage and they're just singing and all of the judges have their back turned to the singer and they're just giving it their all and up there like shining and like wearing, like bearing their whole truth and their whole heart for everyone else. Sorry, I'm kind of stumbling over my words. But the judges can't see. And then there's that moment of truth when the judge says, okay, I believe in you. I don't know who you are. I don't know what you look like. I don't know what your background is, but I believe in you and your potential. And then that chair turns around and they get to see that little old grandma lady who can sing like none other, right? And there's always that surprise element. And those are the episodes that I love like catching or whatever, because it's cool when that it's a surprise. You know, and those judges are like not expecting the person who is just shining so bright. And I just want you to realize that that's your chance here. Like, I invite you to the moment when that chair turns around and people see you and they're surprised at what you have accomplished with your life. And, you know, I don't know. I look forward to that. I think about that with myself, actually, and that's been this little visual in my mind of the chairs turning around has been something that's been really motivating me lately, because I kind of feel like there's people who may have written me off and have been like, all right, you know, Brigida, you know, didn't lead her team to elite the last 2 years, so her best days have passed. And you know what? I don't think our best days have passed by any means. And I'm excited to blow everybody away. Like, it has been on my heart from the first time I signed up as a coach, first time, it's only been one time, from the very beginning, that I just know that this team can be a top 10 team. Like, I believe that in my heart. And I believe that this whole journey has been leading us to that. And so I don't think the best days have come by any means. I think everything that I have gone through has been preparing me to lead that kind of team. And I'm excited for that moment when everyone goes, where did she come from? You know, how did that happen? I thought, you know, she was a has-been. And honestly, you have that same chance. You have that same chance in this business and this opportunity to do some big things. And I just feel that we live with far less than what the Lord is willing to give us. And I should have put that in quotations, because that is a quote that I heard this past weekend. And I'm not trying to make anyone believe in God or anything like that. Put in the universe, whatever. But I just feel that we live beneath ourselves. We live beneath what our potential is. And we are the only ones holding ourselves back. And it's time to go big. Now, with that, I want to point out that it's through still small and simple things that that's going to happen. I think people are like, okay, I'm so ready to do this. I'm so ready to jump back into this business. I'm so ready to be elite. I'm so ready to like finally hit diamond. I'm so ready to finally create that six-figure income, whatever it is. And so you're like, okay, I need to overhaul my life. I need to like have this big surgery on things and do things so massively different. And I just want to point out, it is through small and simple things. It's still, nothing's changed. It's just being consistent with those things. And that's what the power is of a Band-Aid. So kind of a weird analogy here, but I want you to think about the Band-Aid. The Band-Aid is such an inexpensive, convenient, remarkable, versatile solution to so many problems, right? And it's actually the best kind of solution because it's solving a problem with a minimal amount of effort, time, and cost. And I want you to realize that that's your business, right? That if you feel like your business is quote unquote broken and you're like, or maybe it's just never really taken off in the way that you wanted it to, you don't need to go have this massive surgery, right? You don't need to overhaul everything. You don't need to be like, okay, I have to redo all of this training for my team. I don't need to like do these big massive things. Guys, like, remember the power of the Band-Aid in your business to heal wounds. Make the small adjustments and make small little changes and just be consistent with that and trust the process. You know, you're not going to see the result immediately, but just get back to the small and simple things and quote unquote, do your crap. That was a hashtag that Micah Folsom came up for with her team, just hashtag do your crap. And I was like, it's so true. Just do the things that you like, you know, you need to do and go for it. And for myself, as I was making the Band-Aid fixes in my business, as I, one, first realized the negative thoughts I was having, and I was like, okay, I need to release that. I need to get over that. I needed to make some changes in my business. And I asked some other coaches, like, hey, tell me what's working for you. And I got on a couple calls with various coaches and kind of was like, all right, tell me what's working for you right now, because I feel like I'm, in a way, starting over, even though I didn't ever stop. But with this new mindset, I felt like, okay, I'm ready to do things in a different way. So just really quickly, I wanted to share some things that are working for me right now. And this is where I could have shared some screenshots of things and I didn't put that together. So I felt like I already had a massive amount of slides here. But totally Instagram is where it's at. Like Instagram, it's not that I wasn't doing Instagram before. So I didn't have a surgery on my business here. I used a Band-Aid and started using Instagram differently. And that meant for me making sure I was more intentional about following new people, because I wasn't doing that before, and being intentional in sharing my story throughout the day on Instagram stories. I will tell you, just breaking this down for you, that where I've been following new people has not been from hashtags, but I've been going to accounts that I feel the people who follow this account are in my niche market. And so just those big popular accounts that have thousands and thousands of followers, I'm going there and being like, okay, what are the characteristics of someone who's in my niche market and who would they be following? And I'm not doing just one account and I'm just kind of spreading it out on like, you know, my avatar person is going to have a Christian background. They're typically a mom, right? And anyways, going through that to find at least 25 new people for me to follow, to request to follow. I am using the Unfollowers app to track everything, followers app, so then I can notice when someone follows me back. Now, once they follow me back, I'm sending them a message, and it's a really simple hello message of, hey, I hope you don't mind me requesting to follow your page. I love meeting other positive moms here on Instagram, and then I will personalize it to something that I see on their page. So that's my initial go-to hello message, whether it's a, you know, I say that, and then I can see you're on a fitness journey as well, or I can see our kids are about the same age, or I just mentioned something where I'm finding that commonality between us. So that's my just saying hi. From there, I just make a point to comment on Instagram stories and comment on posts and just do the love bomb. And I'm not doing anything where it's like this heavy thing of, oh my gosh, I have to comment on every single person I'm following or comment on every single thing. Like, it's just a few times throughout the day, I'm like, okay, I've got 10 minutes, spend 10 minutes here, 10 minutes here, 10 minutes here. Like, it's not, I don't sit down for an hour and be like, oh my gosh, for the next hour, I have to comment on posts. Like, I don't do that, okay? The other thing that has been working really well for me, I'll tell you, is doing the Insta story poll invites. And if you watch my account, you will have noticed that I've been doing that. And I did that, you know, just following other coaches and seeing what people are doing and talking with people, as I said, of what's working for them. Before I started doing that, I was like sending people the private messages of like, hey, so I know this is random, been following your page. I think you'd really like this girl tribe, like community that I'm putting together. What do you think? And I still felt like it was just kind of out of nowhere. Also, it was not very effective. And so instead, like last week, I did a poll invite every other day, like Monday, Wednesday, Friday, because I had a challenge group starting, you know, so that's not the norm of every other day. But what was cool for me is to see, I had people engage every single day that were different. And that gave me then people to talk to. And so when I do that, I'm giving them two positive options. I never give someone the option of no, like, no, I'm not interested. It's like, yay, sign me up, or send me more information, or like, yes, I'm planning to join you, or tell me more, you know? And that allows me to know who wants to hear from me. Like, who wants to do this? And I will tell you, I feel like people have a curiosity that really drives them to click on that invite poll and see what the ratio is. I swear. Like, and so I try to do a random polls throughout the week. So it's not like those are the only ones that I'm doing. But I really feel like that's made a big difference for me, because instead, when I did a message or a video or a post where I was like, swipe up to message me or send me a message if you're interested, I just was not getting the same engagement. And I don't know, it's just been really exciting for me to see, like, you know, the least amount that I've had is like 9 people who voted yes, you know, send me more information on a poll last week. And all the other polls had more people than that. But I was like, still like 9 people who like wanted information, and that was on Friday. And I wasn't going to do the Friday one, because I'm like, I already have Monday and Wednesday. I'm still talking to those people. But I was like, I'll just do another one. So anyways, I just encourage you to do that. Another thing that I feel is making a difference is just realizing that it's not a production, but like people just want to see me, you know? And so I'm trying to not use the filters. I'm trying to like just show my true authentic self. And I think people can see other coaches that are like so, you know, bigger than life and doing so awesome. They feel like they need to be that and just be you, because I feel like there are people who can see, everyone can see through it, but also people just want to connect with you as a human being and see your flaws and see how you are, like, you know, what are you doing throughout your day? And honestly, it's kind of like a coach sneak peek constantly as someone's watching your Insta stories, because they see what you do. They see you being proof the product works, you're drinking this shake, you're eating healthy, you're coaching, you're with your family, you're juggling all of this. And so I think that's a really cool thing. Another Band-Aid fix. So anyways, that's what's working for me. I just want to say, like, that makes a huge difference. Another thing that was a Band-Aid fix for me was just going back to my story, you know? And I will tell you that I have not felt depressed in so many years that it started to feel really awkward for me to even talk about it, because I just so don't relate to that anymore. And I also was like, oh, I don't want to, you know, attract people who are depressed. Like, I'm happy now. I don't like have anything in common anymore. But identifying it in a different way of realizing that my purpose is to share how I have overcome my greatest pain. And I just want you to write that down. You know, your purpose is to share how you have overcome your greatest pain. Now, your greatest pain doesn't have to be a sob story. Your greatest pain can be like, you know, I'm not passionate about my day. Like, I don't even love what I'm doing. I don't have anything to do. Like, what is your greatest pain? And what have you overcome? And I was able to identify for me that my greatest pain wasn't depression. My greatest pain was feeling like my life was unchangeable. And that brought me a lot of clarity to realize that, you know, because the reason why I was depressed is because I felt like I was helpless to change my life. You know, I felt life was unchangeable when it came to finances, because my husband works. And so my finances are out of my control. Like, if I'm not able to go on that vacation, there's nothing I can do about it. My life is unchangeable. It's his responsibility. My life is unchangeable when it comes to my health. You know, I wasn't born with the genes to eat whatever I want and stay fit and thin. So my life is unchangeable. And for me to realize that that is not true. And I so still feel very strongly about sharing that story and going back to talking about that, you know, that I can authentically say, like, listen, I don't care what your background is, what your story is, any of this, you can change your life. And like that, I can get fired up about and not focus on the part of it that I may not connect with fully. Does that make sense? So again, you know, that was a Band-Aid fix. That was not a surgery, but just a small little adjustment in how I was seeing things that I feel has really made a difference for me. Okay. Now with that, I just wanted to share something. Well, I wish I had written down this quote, but I don't feel that anything is different about this business. If you're jumping back in, you're wanting to grow, blow this up in a big way. I think what makes a difference is how you do it. And there is this quote from Harry Potter. Yes, Harry Potter, that I'm going to read to you. But the quote says, "It was, he thought, the difference between being dragged into the arena to face a battle to the death and walking into the arena with your head held high. Some people perhaps would say that there was little to choose between the two ways. But Dumbledore knew, and so did I, thought Harry, with a rush of fierce pride, and so did my parents, that that was all the difference in the world." And I love that because I think some people will say, I've been doing the activities, I've been making the post, I've been sending the invites. Brigida, I've invited people to my challenge group and it's just not working. And I just want you to realize that how you do it matters. And the biggest thing behind that is your belief, you know, and your passion behind it and that quiet, fierce courage. You know, the difference between being dragged into the arena and walking into that arena with your head held high. Are you, I want to swear, dang proud of what you have to offer? Or are you just sending out the invite because you got to cross it off the checklist, right? Everything that you are doing matters. And it may seem so insignificant to share your workout on Instagram and be like, oh, this is so stupid that I do this. I can't believe this is my job. And to post like this little poll on Instagram, you're like, really, this is my job? I like made a little poll. This is so stupid. But honestly, it matters. All of those little things matter in changing the lives of other people and influencing people for good. And with that, I want to share a couple stories of some extraordinary people and then I'll be done. The first person I want to talk about is George Washington. Don't worry, I'm almost done. I have been thinking about George Washington this weekend, which I know probably sounds a little weird. But I went to this little like seminar thing on the weekend, and one of the speakers pointed out with George Washington how like it was revolutionary that the first person to come into power would step down from it. And there's this documented exchange where George Washington was saying, I want to step down. And all of his advisors were saying, that is the worst decision that you can make right now for our country, because it will make our country seem weak if you step down. And he had this quote that he said, if I say goodbye, the nation learns to move on. It outlives me when I'm gone. And I just have thought about that as he knew to be extraordinary. He needed to create something that would outlive him. And I thought about that and I thought about, you know, what makes something extraordinary? And I feel that what makes something extraordinary is that it does outlive us, you know, that it's forever, it's eternal. And I believe that the knowledge I gain in this life is eternal. I don't believe I believe my spirit goes on, whatever. I won't get in that kind of discussion, but I believe the things that I learn matter. And I believe that I get to carry that with me forever. I believe that the relationships I create and focus on go on forever. I believe that the experiences that I have, I get to carry those memories with me forever. Those are the things that are extraordinary about my life. Those are the things that matter. And I want you to think about the legacy that you are leaving for your future generations. And is it extraordinary? Is it gonna like is your story going to stand the test of time? There's another person who was extraordinary, and his name was Woodrow Arrington. Woodrow Arrington was my grandfather. And when he was a little boy, his dad worked on the railroads. And he came from a long line of hillbillies. And none of them, you know, got an education, learned to read, you know, like they were true hillbillies. And his dad worked on the railroad. And so his family would sleep in the train carts. And so they didn't really have a home. They just went from train cart to train cart. And, you know, wherever his dad could find work. But Woodrow, as a little boy, would collect pennies for doing odd jobs in a jar. And he wanted to get an education. And so he learned to read. He, like, did his schooling, like, in the cart, like, taught himself all of these things and applied to go to college. And he had his money all saved up that he had saved literally from his entire childhood. And he had them in these glass jars. I'm not kidding. And he got into Idaho State University. And on his first day of school, he had not yet taken all of this money to the bank yet and make a deposit. And he was robbed. And all of his money was gone that he had literally saved since he was a kid. And I'm blown away with what he did next, because he went to the president of the university and said, I came here for an education and I'm not leaving. And this president was so impressed with Woodrow that he let him sleep in the janitor office of the college and work, and essentially gave him a loan and said, you will pay this back, you know, and gave him a scholarship, but not a scholarship, I mean, truly a loan. But this was right as the Depression hit. And so, I mean, there just was not money, you know, and the fact that he was like, I'm not leaving. I came here for an education. And after that first year, he worked so hard, sleeping in the janitor office and showing up and doing good in classes, that the president of the college said, your loan has been paid in full. Like, I'm so impressed with you. Like, I'm counting it like complete, even though it wasn't. And I just have to tell you that the legacy that this man has left for me and my whole family, like, I love that story. And many times I think of, am I living up to the name that has been given to me and my heritage? Because he was a change agent in my family. Like, if it were not for him, I would be a hillbilly. Like, I wouldn't, like, value education. I wouldn't have, like, you know, he just changed the generations to come because he drew that line in the sand. And you have that same chance, right? Like, what legacy and impact and what stories will your children, your grandchildren share about you one day? Will you be that change agent for your family? Whether it's in being an entrepreneur. Okay, can you hear me okay? Oh, dang it, I was like in the groove here. Okay, so I need someone though to make a comment here and tell me what the last thing is that you heard me say. I mean, I think I was really just sharing the story of let me open the chat. Yes, that he was a change agent. Thank you. All right, almost done. Oh, but I better hit record for this too. One second. Okay, it's recording. As I was saying though, like, I just think of all of our opportunities to be a change agent for our children, for our grandchildren, and the stories that they will tell about us, and how you have a chance to change the genealogy to come with living a healthy lifestyle of, like, no, you serve. You spend your days in service and helping other people. There's another story of someone who is extraordinary, and I want to share his story here in a video. So let me open up a different screen here. This is another change agent story I want you guys to see.
I'm Scotty Hobbs. I want to tell our story with Beachbody. I've been a coach now for 14 months, but I want to tell you a little bit of how we started and how much our lives have changed. I became a coach in April 11th of 2011, so 14 months ago. I'd gone through a P90X transformation on my own, and I had started helping people get in shape with programs like P90X and Insanity, and I was offered the coaching opportunity. When I decided to become a coach, I made the decision because I needed it to happen for our family. We were struggling financially. I worked 12 hours a day from 5 in the morning to 5 at night, and my wife was at work from 3 in the afternoon until 11 at night. So the kids were at a babysitter for 2 hours a day, and I only saw my wife on the weekends, and we just weren't together as a family. And I watched my coach succeed with Beachbody as a coach and start to change lives. And I decided that I wanted to do that. And if I were to help other people change their lives and help them achieve their goals, if that would give me a chance to be with my family, I knew I would do whatever it took to make that happen. So that day, you know, I decided and I made a commitment. Not just a decision that I was going to do it. I committed myself that I would change my family's life. And as many people as I could help and that were willing to commit, I would help them along the way. So here's my story.
You won't notice me. I'll be leaving my mark like initials carved in an old oak tree. You wait and see. Maybe I'll write like Twain wrote. Maybe I'll paint like Van Gogh. Cure the common cold. I don't know, but I'm ready to start. Cause I know in my heart I wanna do something matters. Say something different. Something that sets the whole world on its ear. I wanna do something better. With the time I've been given, I wanna try to touch a few hearts in this fight. Leave nothing left, something that says I was here. I will prove you wrong. If you think I'm all talk, you're in for a shock, cause the street's too strong, and before too long. Maybe I'll compose symphonies, maybe I'll fight for world peace, cause I know it's my destiny to leave more than a trace of myself in this place. Wanna do something that matters, say something different, something that sets the whole world on its ear. I wanna do something better for the time I've been given. I wanna try to touch a few hearts in this life, even if there's something that says I was here. I know that I will do more than just pass through this life. I'll leave nothing left but something that says I was here. I'm here.
let me come this over now to the slides back. I literally cannot watch that without tearing up. And I've seen it a million times, but I cannot deny that Scotty Hopps has been a huge inspiration for me and a ripple effect in my life. And honestly, I just look at, like, I guess the song, like all of it, that I'm like, guys, we have a chance to do something that is extraordinary, something that is going to outlive us. And I don't know, I think maybe because I have this long history of like, dude, I don't want to be here in life. And then, okay, I'll just like get through it. And now I'm like, I want to live. Like, I want to do something. And that is your opportunity here. Like, are you going to leave a story? Are you going to do something where people can say you were here, that it was obvious because of the people that you influenced, the difference that you made in other people's lives, and the ripple effect that you had in other people's lives? Because here's the thing. If you hold yourself back, you will cheat the world of your contribution. And guys, I don't think that we need to ask the mission to bow down to our limiting beliefs and our limiting strengths. I think we get to rise up to match the mission and the opportunity that has been presented to us all. Because at the end of your life, one day you're going to ask, how did I get here? And it won't be if you ask yourself that question, but how you ask yourself that question. If you're asking yourself that question with a bunch of exclamation points because you're so freaking blown away with the life that you've created and the ripple effect that you have had in other people's lives, or you're going to be asking, how did I get here, with a bunch of question marks, completely dumbfounded because you weren't intentional with your days and you weren't intentional with this opportunity. Guys, this is your chance. So I say it's time to do something big and go for it. So that's it. Thank you all for being a part of this call and tuning in, and I'll see you guys.